Thank you, and thank you really for the invitation. I'm very, very pleased to be part of this international symposium. I go to share the PowerPoint. I try. Okay, do you see it?
Yeah.
Okay, good. The starting point of my reflection is the feeling, the strong feeling that today we are not faced with some accidental and transitory pathologies of communication. I mean, fake news, infodemic, and so on, but with some communication modes, communication patterns, which are part of a new discursive regime in the Foucauldian sense, Michel Foucault, that has changed in depth and that must be studied in its systemic aspect, I think. So first of all, in my short speech, first of all, I will try to outline some old categories that are no longer suitable for the new regime. And this is a sort of pars destrans. Then I will outline two new models, which in my opinion are becoming more and more widespread. And at the end, I will suggest in very few minutes a sort of alternative to our beloved criterion of truth. When I speak in terms of regime, I mean that our new tools of communication, digital tools, are not just instruments which allow us to transmit content. Media shapes our world and they contribute to the creation of a sphere with its own logic, its own criteria for legitimation, its own standards and its own rules. These rules define what is possible, what is legitimate, and then what is true. This is why, in my view, the problem of post-truth regime is not merely a problem of communication, of mediatic poisoning in a way. The problem is deeper, maybe, and it has to do with the criterion of truth and where and how the authorization to set this criteria come from. So here you find a list that Michel Foucault made in an interview, The Political Function of the Intellectual, that is a sort of reprise of Discipline and Punish, where Foucault clarified that each society has its own regime of truth. And this regime of truth that each society defines has to do with these features and these problems. The types of discourse are both and causes to function as true. The mechanism and instances which enable one to distinguish true from false statement, the way in which each is sanctioned, the techniques and procedures which are valorized for obtaining truth, the status of those who are charged with saying what counts as truth. So what is resumed in this list, I think, that truth is a very system of ordered procedures for the production, regulation, distribution, circulation, and functioning of statements, of discourses. So is something much more complex, I think, that than what we were considering truth, according one, the most important criterion of our Western culture, that was the criterion of correspondence. So the first old idea that today, in my opinion, is not any more suitable is the idea of truth as correspondence. Why? The idea of correspondence entails a dimension of accessible and observable factuality that is independent of us. On the one hand, there is reality. On the other hand, the discourses on reality. And the more these two elements correspond, the more the discourse will be true and the reality will be manifest. The problem, in my opinion, is not if this objective level of reality exists or not. I can assume that it exists, but there are two problems. What I mean today with reality, and the speech by Ruggero Eugeni has already problematized this question. And how can I access to it in order to shape a discourse adequate corresponding to this level? About reality, I think that thanks to a slow evolution of traditional media and textual media genres, this category has profoundly changed. Thanks, first of all, to the traditional media, television, I mean, the category of reality that we use today, what seems normal to us to consider reality, is much more complex and much more hybrid. On the one hand, the mix that television has been carrying on between different genres since the 80s, information, entertainment, real politics, has confused different criterion of reality. What is real in a TV studio is not the same as in a scientific laboratory. On the other hand, we have become more and more accustomed to putting different enunciation on the same level. So in a reality show, a public figure can speak to his electorate or can build his electorate. I would like to mention you an extraordinary case of our contemporary times, I think. The cases of the elected president in Ukraine, Volodymyr Zelensky. Zelensky is the protagonist of a fiction, Servitor of the Nation, more or less, and this is the only formation cursus honorum he got. And in this fiction, the story of this fiction was that very normal people, a teacher, a school, became a president of the Ukraine because of a message, a viral message in a social. And the real story of this president, the election of this president, I don't know anything about his politics right now, but the election of this person was a sort of mirror of what in the fiction where he was the main character was shown. So in this kind of mixed, I think we gradually change the criteria of reality. Reality does not have to do with what is given, what happens, the level of the events, but it can be prepared, scripted, arranged like a speech, but remaining reality. Again, let's think about reality show. They are real, but in a special meaning of real. So the category of realities has changed, but there is also the problem of accessibility. We have today an apparent widespread accessibility with a satellite view. We can see a road in a country very far from ours. With a little research, we can access from our desk to a manuscript, which is deposited in the French National Library. We can see, and I really say see, at a great distance what happens inside a body, an organ, and maybe someone can lead a surgery per distance. So everything is or seems accessible to many people, but actually we access to another mediation of reality, a visual shot within a discursive frame, through and thanks to a given mediatic tool. This generalized accessibility makes everything just hyper-mediated. Thus, the most interesting aspect, I think, of what happens today, even when faced with a very simple descriptive statement, I don't know, there was an accident along my route an hour ago, is not to verify whether the statement corresponds to an event that actually happened or not, but to decide whether or not to trust the person saying this statement. Because the levels of mediation and distancing from reality, in fact, have multiplied. Obviously, we could say that all these questions have something to do in some way with the old problem of correspondence of the statements to facts. But the point refers more to the nature of the sentences, their reasons, their origins, their truthfulness. And truthfulness is a weaker notion than truth, I think. It is something that has to do with accuracy, honesty, credibility, subjective components of interpretative accounts. I believe that this extreme accessibility is a noteworthy communicative feature of our time, and judging the truth of these pieces of reality using particular correspondence criteria is simply inadequate, empirically impossible, and I will say rather uninteresting, because the interesting part is precisely the stratification or mediation that immediately shapes the initial information data. So we shift, I think, from truth, a matter of presumptive objectivity, to truthfulness, a matter of negotiable interpretation. The many versions of the fact progressively multiply, and all we can do is retrace their paths of formation, but we cannot verify their correspondence to reality. Reality is in and through those interpretative layers. In light of this acceleration and overproduction of reality mediations, the idea of verification and proof, which I've mentioned before as the second old idea about truth, also seemed to lose its place on any genuine path of discovery. Verification today seems neither a matter of correspondence nor one a genuine argumentative assessment, genuine comparison, or in-depth procedures. I am not generically stating that people today are superficial, is not the point. I'm saying that today, the information world works in a way that systematically discourages genuine forms of verification. The verification was based on the idea that there was an objective state to be reconstructed. Verifying traditionally meant making sure that things were in a certain way or bringing certain evidences of a certain statement to the world. Today, we are observing completely different dynamics of the elaboration of judgments. We tend to live in information bubbles and to strengthen our beliefs. Is not a psychological phenomenon, but something set by the algorithms of our way of living online, we know. And the result is that a kind of familiar micro world is structured around each one of us, a micro world that filters and leaves out everything that is foreign to us. We are in contact with thousands of people we share our same tastes and opinions, and we receive thousands of suggestions and information selected so perfectly for us that we feel no need to expand the boundaries of our world. In these bubbles, it's difficult to build authentic argumentative paths because confirmation mechanisms are strengthened. All the typical elements of a genuine discovery, of a verification path, a surprising fact, a different point of view, a different premise, are minimized, whilst the most recurrent rhetorical pathways seem to be paralogism, tautologies, generalization, discursive moves which give only the impression of an argumentative progress. In these bubbles where confirmation bias dominates, facts are almost always reinforced facts, convincing facts for all beyond question, according to an absolutizing mechanism that ends up giving weight, giving reality to discursive stratification that are independent of any real assessment. And this aspect brings to me to the third classical approach to truth that today seems inadequate, the idea of sincerity. It should be a basic, pragmatic, and ethical rule of communication, as theorized by Grice in his conversational maxim, be truthful, says in his maxim of quality. Do not say what you believe to be false, and do not say something for which you lack adequate evidence. But this maxim seems to be less and less relevant. Not only it is disregarded, in fact, but it is no longer even a criterion. And this is the interesting and worrying point about the post-truth regime. The discursive functioning of the contemporary infosphere requires a continuous intervention. We seem to no longer have the right to not react, and any lack of adequate evidence cannot be an obstacle to this continual solicitation. We must go further. We feel called to react, for example, with a retweet, and we do not perceive this discursive reaction as the continuation of a speech. We do not feel responsible for this speech, for a retweeting. In this way, the kind of sincerity criterion that arises is an emotional, not a cognitive one. Sincere today means to be sympathetic to someone, not to be honest about reality. Thus, the very category of communicative commitment has changed. So we have seen that all the traditional ways of setting the problem of truth, the traditional paradigms of truth are increases, but if so, how does the truth manifest itself and how is it legitimized today in our media? My opinion is that today we have two communication model strengthened. The one can correspond to what Umberto Eco called the hermetic model. The other one is a gossip model. The first one, the hermetic model, Eco outlines two models at the basis of the Western culture. A rational model based on a criterion of linearity, on causal logic and the principle of non-contradiction, perfectly expressed by the modus ponens, and the hermetic model, which was mainly developed during the Renaissance, based on a different non-linear type of logic that is not defined by the principle of non-contradiction, and if anything is founded on the criterion of similarity. What is most interesting to me about Eco's reflection is precisely the accentuation in the hermetic model on the paradigm of similarity and the logic of the secret. Similarity becomes a criterion of interpretation and knowledge because when causal consequentiality is no longer valid, the most legitimate path is the associative one, and the associative process is based on similarity of element. when the principle of non-contradiction fails and an associative modality is authorized, the drift becomes inevitable. But let's go very shortly to say something about the gossip model. What I mean with gossip? Gossip is the exchange of personal information, positive or negative, in an evaluative way, positive or negative, about absent third party. Yeah. A few minutes.
Ce lo ricordi ancora?
Okay. In terms of anthropology and psychology, a sort of inevitable tendency seen in small social communities. It consolidates community ties and helps alike with inside with outside. Gossip, according to some major scholars, has four social function: facilitates the flow of information.
Professor, we have to conclude.
Yeah. Provides a form of recreation, strengthens influence, and creates group solidarity. So gossip has a social function, but is dealing with a performative criterion, not with a declarative criterion. Gossip is not interested in truth, is interested in strengthening social ties. So the very last slide. In this context in which the traditional paradigms are in crisis, I believe that a criterion still valid could be that of legitimacy, in order to rethink those of correctness, objectivity, and adequacy. We know the distinction between legality and legitimacy. It has already been drawn, and it is the distance between a formal criterion, legality, void of content, and a criterion, legitimacy, that finds its foundation not in form, but in appropriateness, that has an historical cultural foundation. So, legitimacy depends on conformity with rules and with a preliminary form of appropriateness that makes the exercise of power, the exercise of discourse adequate. In order to say and fix what is legitimate, you must have the right to do so.
Thank you. Professor,
thank you.
We have to conclude.
Yes.
Sorry. And thank you for your. We can read in your abstract and in the paper. Thank you very much.